Hey, hopefully I caught you in time and hopefully I'm not too late. ROG, a republic of gamers. They make motherboards, they make laptops. They make computer peripherals, including controllers. And not your standard missionary gamepads either, but those premium or pro controllers that all the kids like. So when I'm walking down the aisles of Best Buy and I see a $180 controller over my shoulder, I get a little curious what this new Titan brings to the pro controller world and why it should stand shoulder to shoulder amongst that price point with Scuff, Aim, Battle Beaver, Hex, Evil, Cinch, Mega Mods, just to name a few that are on the top of the dome. Let's do the most in-depth comprehensive review of this bad boy for YouTube. That is exactly what we're here to do here today, but to save your time right up front, this is a bottom feeder of the pro controller world, a little catch and release, if you will. In fact, I wouldn't even toss a hook out for it because the three standardized features, it's funny to say standardized for pro controllers, but the three staples, the essentials that we've come to expect from pro controllers are present here, but in such a shittily implemented way. Combine that with build quality that is utterly disgusting for a $180 controller and styling choices such as a built-in screen that leave me scratching my rump wondering why, because this money could have been reallocated towards better quality components. And despite the fact that I am a little bit of a ROG fanboy, I have several of their devices, I use them daily, my PC, and I've got the ROG Ally handheld. Controller-wise, look elsewhere because there is a vast world of premium, custom, and pro controllers that will defecate.
This is your controller captain. We've reached 6,900 feet. Go ahead and start flicking the sticks and mollywopping the back paddles.
You don't like back paddles? How about those rear buttons?
We've tested almost 100 custom and premium controllers, and we're only at the beginning.
You need a thumbstick guide or a tutorial on how to overclock your controller?
Check out the controller playlist.
Bing bong.
Controller captain out.
Get the bluff or bottom line up front out of the way. This controller feels incredibly cheap for its price point. Things like the face buttons, Dpad, triggers, definitely those rear buttons, which is the main stapler feature of a pro controller. And over the last 4 to 5 years, there's been a huge influx of controllers that are really packing a lot of really good features into a not very expensive package. So price to performance, bang for buck, if you will. So you don't need to spend hundreds of dollars to get premium or pro controller features. You can get something like the Gamepad G7, which is $45 and has clicky face buttons, remappable rear buttons, and a pretty good software suite. But if you want to spend hundreds of dollars, 2 to 4, you can customize something that looks unlike anybody else's controller and has some really slick features. But as a controller aficionado, a connoisseur, if you will, I fill up my wine glasses not with Merlot, but with melted down PCBs from gamepads and whiff up all that silicone, and that probably caused cancer. Anyway, when I discover a controller like the ROG Raikiri Pro, I'm not a huge fan of the name either, it's just silly, the Raikiri Pro over here. There's also a Raikiri not Pro or standard version. Both of these controllers, which both hold a premium price tag, but the one we're focusing on here today is $170 from Best Buy, but out the door with tax and shipping, you're looking at $182.74. Keep in mind, you also have to drag your ass down to a brick and mortar Best Buy or order from Best Buy online, because Asus has an exclusive partnership with Best Buy. So if you're trying to get a ROG Ally handheld, you're going to get it through Best Buy or the massively confusing Asus website. I think what really grabbed me, drew me in to test this controller, other than several requests and it being my job, obviously, is the styling. Cosmetically, I think it looks really cool in the pictures and the little teaser trailer videos I've seen. But as soon as you unbox it and put your corneas on the actual cheap porous plastics and see what you're dealing with, all of that sensualness just fades away and you're left looking at what you can clearly tell is like an $80 gamepad that's been doubled in price. Furthermore, this controller does have wireless compatibility on the PC via a dongle, but you cannot use this wirelessly on Xbox, which I think is incredibly stinky considering this is a freakishly expensive controller. And if you're already in this price point, why the hell not just go through the builder on a custom controller company such as Hyper, Cinch, Evil, Mega Mods, Aim. Aim has a lifetime warranty, by the way. Doesn't cover stick drift, but covers a lot of other components. So the one redeeming factor that this controller had for me, cosmetically looking sexy, when you actually see it in person, it's not nearly as kick-ass as it looks in pictures. And having a screen is just a gimmicky feature because software never really implements those screens very well. There's not much you can do with them. Now, if it was implemented with each game where you had like a health bar or something, or you could see what weapon you had selected, that's still a gimmicky feature because all that information's on screen and you'd have to look down at your controller. If there was something that you could do other than just battery life, the small implementations of these screens that we're seeing, that'd be cool. But it's just an expensive feature. It adds to the manufacturing costs, adds to the cost of the controller for us, and doesn't really add anything to the user experience.
As for the packaging, included accessories on ROG's $180 Titan. The outer box is letting you know that this is for Xbox and that this bad boy has won 2 awards. Generally, if manufacturers have to flex that their controller has won awards, the core key features are actually slipping like a bad transmission. They are pointing out the 4 remappable rear buttons, the built-in OLED screen, which has minimal functionality, the trigger stops, which don't stop much, and the built-in software, which is actually Armory Crate, the same program you'll be using for your motherboard if you have a Asus computer. I will say Asus's gaming division ROG does the whole gamerific packaging very well. The branding looks really cool. And this is the same on all their products. Pictures on screen of a recent laptop unboxing. Little catchphrase or slogan for those who dare. I shouldn't have dared to pay $180 for this controller. You do have a couple of foam blocks holding your gamepad in place, which I do like. Your controller, which through the lens of picture and video actually looks pretty good, but through the actual ocular cavities, through the eyeballs, cheap, cheap, cheap. Little cutout for your finger to slide into gently. 10-foot USB-C cable, braided, relatively lightweight and flexible. You do have a little rubber tie back that does stay connected. You also have some pretty aggressive Asus branding on the USB-A side. No dust covers on the A or C end, but this is actually a pretty good included cable, which is important because on Xbox, you are going wired if you do get this gamepad.
No! God, please, no! No!
Then you have their second catchphrase or marketing slogan in search of incredible.
This controller's not incredible.
Your package content, if you're missing any of this, Houston, we have a problem. Kevin, where the hell's my wireless dongle? You have a very cheap plastic tray or door, which isn't held on very securely. In fact, it was popped off loosely in the box when I unboxed this bad boy. Have your transmitter or receiver, I should say. Controller's the transmitter. This is the receiver in the back of the controller, which I do like that design aspect that you can't really lose this despite the fact there is no included carrying case, which is kind of stinky at $180. But I do like that the one loose included accessory just slides in the back of the controller. English is actually the only language. So if that's not your native tongue, you're going to have to go online for a digital manual.
As for the warranty, which by the way, the warranty information card is actually bigger than the instruction manual or quick start guide, but I had to read through the fine print, and Asus is taking the minimum wage approach here, where they literally cite going with the lowest legal coverage, depending on your geographic area, which in North America is 1 year. There is a standardized consumer electronics law where products have to be covered by 1 year of coverage. However, is anyone ever actually trying to take these companies to small claims court, wasting time and money that you probably don't have to fucking sit in a courtroom dicking around with some company over a $180 chunk of plastic that they should have just had an actual periodic warranty coverage for 6 months, 1 year, 2 years, etc. There's no actual time frame here. Part of that is the fact that Asus is a multi-product company, so they make computer components, peripherals, and if you go on their website, there's an entire warranty page that breaks out all their products, and controllers would technically fall into this 1 year of coverage. It'd be cool if they just said, hey, we have 1 year of coverage. That's our standardized warranty. And the reason I'm even up in wiles about a warranty is that this controller feels so gosh darn cheap. This feels cheaper than a standard Xbox controller, which you can get for $45 to $60 on Amazon. They're constantly running some weird promotion or sale. Every single part and component feels incredibly cheap and thrown together. The panel gaps, seams where the front faceplate and rear shell meet, incredibly huge. This 3.5 millimeter headphone jack from a parts bin special. All these buttons feel like they've been reused from previous controllers from 2 decades ago, but at least it has a USB-C port. That's, you know, give credit where credit's due, but all these plastics, incredibly cheap and chintzy, and this does not feel like a $180 gamepad. It doesn't feel like a $60 gamepad. And it feels like this warranty is going to be a bitch to get honored because it says, hey, we're going to do the bare minimum and, you know, whatever's legally not going to get us sued is what we're going to give you. And real quick, just to explain what I'm judging build quality on, this isn't a light controller by any means. It's over 300 grams, so it's actually quite hefty. And I don't give a damn about some rubberized soft touch material. Yes, that feels good on the fingertips, but it really comes down to the plastics feeling incredibly cheap. Also, face buttons wiggle on pretty much any controller when you grab them and jiggle them back and forth, but they do that more on this controller. Them not going for rubberized grips, I actually found out directly from an Asus representative that was a strategic move because they thought they would peel off and whatnot. Nothing wrong with that. In fact, a lot of my audience has pointed out in the comment section that they prefer plastic over rubberized grips because they wear out on them over time. Well, that's cool and all. I respect that. I do think that rubberized grips feel a little bit better on the hands, and I snagged 6 controllers that I own with rubberized grips. I do have a couple more, but these are the ones that were easily accessible, just so we can quickly review that whole durability argument. Microsoft Elite Core, got that at launch. Now you're a cutie patootie. Scuf Instinct Pro for the Xbox, bought that at launch. Had that for over 2 years now. As you can see, not ripped or torn or anything.
mint condition. Scuff reflex, purchase date on screen. Aim V3, don't ask why I have the paddles removed. And then a PlayStation 5 and Xbox variant from Hyper. But mint condition, none of these are peeling or anything, and I've had a lot of these controllers for over a year. The reason I kind of wanted to explain myself in a little further detail is I actually had a really nice one-on-one video chat with an Asus representative, and we talked about a lot of their products, peripherals, including the Raikiri Pro, the controller that I'm reviewing here today. And I basically told the gentleman that this review is going live today. I wasn't a huge fan of the controller, but you know, it did some things good. For somebody that tests and reviews controllers from a quantity standpoint, yes, I have reviewed more controllers than any other channel that I've discovered, but also from a quality standpoint, I definitely do a shitload of research and spend a lot of time with these controllers, not only in software programs like Gamepad Tester and overclocking, but also using the sons of bitches on their consoles or PCs that they're meant for. So I can give you my honest thoughts. And a lot of times when these companies try and do damage control or at least explain the complaints that reviewers have, sometimes they make sense and you see that design aspect from a new angle and you think, oh, that actually makes sense. Maybe I won't put that in my review or I'll explain why they made that design choice. Other times that really isn't the case. For example, not going with rubberized grips. That's cool. I get that you don't want them to wear out over time, but that wasn't even a thought that entered my head when I mentioned that this controller has terrible build quality. It's the general feel of when you pick up that controller, you think, if you were to close your eyes, you would think that you just picked up an Xbox controller, a stock Xbox controller. That's not great when you're spending $180, and it might be a little bit more difficult to return because you have to go directly through Best Buy. Although I will say Best Buy is a lot like Walmart and Amazon, where if you don't like a product, you can just explain to them that, and they'll usually take her back for you. Post that chat, you sent me an email with some pretty in-depth information about the development of this controller, including some testing figures, and they really do a lot of torture testing, durability testing, so despite the fact that it feels incredibly cheap, it should last for you in the long term, at least as good as other controllers on the market, if not better, but it's not very confidence-inducing when you grab the son of a bitch, and you yourself watching this video aren't going to have access to all those statistics and numbers I saw where they're talking about torsion strength, you know, impact resistance and all this stuff, which a lot of it, unless you're taking your controller on some kind of tactical op to Fallujah or something, you're sitting in your living room, not dropping the controller. Anyway, like I told that representative, I'm a pretty big fan of ROG products. I have one of their high-end motherboards in my PC that I built on the channel. I just bought a $4,000 Zephyrus gaming laptop with dual screens that's Republic of Gamers. That will be reviewed in the near future. It is a really cool piece of tech. Only laptop I've seen with a built-in second screen that works exactly like I thought it would for productivity, video editing, and whatnot. And then I have the ROG Ally handheld, which after my initial comparison of the Steam Deck and that, my opinion has kind of swayed a little bit, and I've been playing a lot more on the Ally than I have the Steam Deck. For example, Starfield runs practically not at all or really shitty on the Steam Deck. ROG Ally, when I bumped it down to 720p and upscaled with FSR, I was between 45, 55 frames per second playing Starfield. This controller just ain't it, brother. Okay, continue with the review. This was a little insert with some of my thoughts, separate day and everything. I'm editing the video, but then last night I had that talk with the Asus representative and I wanted to share my thoughts as to did that sway my opinion of this review or anything? Not really, because all the points that I'm making in this review still stand 110% because a lot of them are my personal opinion as someone that has put their hands on so many gosh darn gamepads in a similar price point. And for full transparency, Asus reached out to me to set up a point of contact and also talk about maybe future collaboration, product reviews, stuff like that. One of the main talking points was indeed the Raikiri Pro controller, as I noticed that a lot of my niche content is controller reviews and kind of wanted to get my opinion on the controller on that call, but I didn't really give much information, so they're going to be seeing this review as you do, basically get all my in-depth critiques then, at which point I'm sure they're going to reach out again. And real quick, can we take just a moment to acknowledge how crazy and cool it is that I'm getting reached out to by companies like Dell when I was making videos tanking on their Alienware computers, more so not tanking on them, but I owned one at the time and I was doing tutorials trying to make it better because the cooling, the thermals were pretty garbage. And when I was just shy of 40,000 subscribers, Razer reached out to me because they caught wind of a budget mouse review that I had done and wanted to know if they could use it on their website. I don't know if they ever actually did, but I told them go ahead. But that's just so neat. I mean, look at me. I don't even do my hair half the time and I'm over here having in-depth heart-to-heart talks,
staring into the corneas of representatives of Asus and Dell and whatnot. It's fantastic. I'd love to see that. I'd love to live through it.
As I pull off this cover for the OLED screen, which probably just should have been left out of the design. I like what Asus tried to do here with this little two-tone pattern. It could have been so slick, but it isn't because there's this huge panel gap where this part meets. As you can see, it just looks like a tack-on, an add-on, an afterthought. And honestly, I think they went a little bit too aggressive, too gaudy, too gamerific with the design. I will say at least they left it kind of a gray as opposed to having lime green trim down the side or something, since it is a licensed Xbox product. Cosmetically, this controller is a little bit too rambunctious for me, and then you see this home button, which I swear to God was ripped directly from either PDP or Power A controllers that you've been seeing on Walmart shelves for $35 for over 10 years. Just this little jewel right here really does F up the looks. This should have been blacked out or something. It just looks out of place here. Also, this font or lettering looks incredibly cheap, like it's gonna wear off just from pressing the buttons. Also, look at that side-to-side play, that wiggledy-biggle on these buttons. That's stinky and silly for such an expensive controller. And of course, it's got that RGB or red, green, briggity blue. Let me turn off the lights. You can see what's going down in the DM, so to speak. Unfortunately, them glowing gamer lights are not enough to save it in the cosmetics department, and it still looks like a sack of crap. Cosmetics, I'm gonna go ahead and give it a 4 out of 10. Repeat, 4 out of 10. As for the D-pad or direction buttons on the Raikiri Pro over here, I don't feel personally offended, but I'm just not a fan of this D-pad whatsoever. It is taking a wheel design. However, there are not 8 distinct steps or gates, so there is no diagonal input, so your diagonal inputs are going to be registered by you pressing both down and left, up and right, etc. Also, the plastic that's making contact with your thumb doesn't feel great. This isn't removable or anything. It'd be cool if it had a swappable 4-point option as well. I tried playing a retro platformer style game, Broforce. It's a modern game, but kind of a retro platformer style using just the D-pad, and it was okay, but no means was it the most satisfying experience. And if you're playing a lot of retro platformers where you're using this D-pad a lot, look elsewhere. As for the face or action buttons, they feel incredibly cheap, not only in the actual actuation of it, pressing them down feels incredibly cheap, sounds incredibly cheap. Also, a lot of side-to-side play or wiggle, which you don't hear a whole heck of a lot of when I swing it back and forth. That's good. Some controllers sound like a toy when you do that. Doesn't feel great. The Dpad, I don't know why I said it like that, depends, you know, the adult diapers. The Dpad and the face buttons are gonna be a 4. So if you add them up, that's an 8, a score that could have been given to each individual component. As for the accessory button suite, so that is gonna be this incredibly cheap Xbox button, this OLED screen, your pause options and share buttons, this 3.5 millimeter headphone jack, which looks weird being off to the left like that, not centered. And then your pairing button, which also doubles as a mic mute button. These buttons suck. They are incredibly small. They're also sunken almost flush with the rear shell and kind of a bitch to hit when you're quickly trying to pause your game. The home button also feels just incredibly cheap. Oh, turned her on. Profile 2. Republic of Gamers. Make a better controller. It does have RGB though, which, I mean, you know. Accessory button suite's gonna get a 4 out of 10 for me as well. As for these thumbsticks, analog sticks, joysticks, these are not swappable, not removable, which is definitely one of those standardized pro controller features, the 3 being swappable thumbstick caps, remappable rear buttons, or back paddles, doesn't matter. Buttons do be better than paddles generally, but some kind of rear input system. And then trigger locks or stops, some way to cut out some of that travel. So when you're playing shooting games, you get a nice tactile mouse click. I don't know why I'm using these like an example. That's not what you get here. But yeah, no swappable thumbstick caps here. And the stock caps actually do feel pretty good. Very similar to stock Xbox thumbstick caps. Maybe a skosh grippier, actually. The rubber silicone compound they're using is actually pretty good. No anti-friction rings. However, it is still pretty smooth plastic around the outside of the thumbstick gates. So no issue there. As for control freak compatibility, I've got some white galaxies for PlayStation 4 and 5, which use the same thumbstick caps. These are so loose and wiggly, I wouldn't even attempt to do it. These are red infernos for the Nintendo Switch Pro controller. Loose and wiggly, don't even do it. These are Omnis for Xbox One and Series, which also use the same thumbstick caps. And these bad boys fit like a dream. Let's see what these can do in Gamepad Tester, shall we? Ooh, might have to cash in that 1-year warranty. Whatever your local jurisdiction says we gotta do for the warranty, we'll do it, but not a day longer. Over here in the one, the only, the Gamepad Tester, we have a good resting value of 0.00002, so no out-of-the-box stick drift. Very responsive, very, very taut dead zones. As soon as I provide input, they are moving. Let's test that circularity, which, by the way, some little weirdo in the comment section commented on my in-depth tutorial with Gamepad Tester recently, saying the circularity test is only, get this, to measure that your thumbsticks spin in a circle. But the circularity test is only designed to show you that your thumbsticks are in a circle. Well, yes, that is an obvious statement that it is showing you the shape of a circle, and if your thumbsticks are showing anything else, a triangle, a rhombus, a square, a hexagon, then you have a fucking problem. But furthermore, you can actually see specific areas. So let's say top left is starting to go out on a controller, where I press forward and left in game, and my character is barely walking or not even moving at all. And then I plug it into Gamepad Tester, and lo and behold, kind of hard to replicate that situation, but I could grab a shitty controller that has blowed out thumbsticks to show you, but it'll actually be chopping off that one area. I just wanted to address that real quick, that there's a ton of information you can see in the circularity test as far as your minimum and maximum of where your thumbsticks are going to go, where they might be chopping or not registering movements. It's not just showing you that your thumbsticks are in a circle. Jesus Christ. Anywho, taking a deep breath, relaxing my beaver after that, we have a very good average error rate. Generally, a 1% is the lowest that you're going to see on potentiometer thumbstick modules or Hall effects for that matter. They'll get down there, that 1% range. That's good. That is a very, very accurate thumbstick. I like that.
These bumpers do feel identical to a standard Xbox One or Series controller. The plastics actually do feel a little bit cheaper because it doesn't have that stippling. No issues actuating with the meat or pad of my index finger as well as the tip. They feel fine, work as they should, 5 out of 10. As for the triggers, to make sure that marketing feature was ticked on the box, there are trigger locks or stop. However, they are two-way, so on or off, and when they are engaged, that's the full pull right there. That's engaged. Cuts out about 75% of the pull, leaving you with a quarter. I'd like if it cut out a little bit more, leaving you only about 5 or 10% of your squeeze. That would be ideal, or even better yet, becoming a nice mechanical tactile switch. But this is what the triggers sound like with the trigger stops engaged. Actually pretty silent and secure sounding. You can also engage and disengage these while you're holding the controller normally gaming. And while it would have been cool to see some 3 or 5 way trigger stops or some stops that become an actual mechanical tactile mouse click or digital switches as these controller companies like to call them, you don't see that here, but these aren't terrible. Don't offend me. I'm gonna give them a 7 out of 10. 7 out of 10. Now this award at Gamer Heaven dynamically changes or fluctuates, and it's been given to several controllers over the years. Worst rear paddle design has been given to the old school scuff design, which Corsair, the parent company of SCUF, has done away with for a new design, which is much, much better.
And the PowerA Fusion Pro 1 and 2. The 3 has buttons instead of paddles, thank God.
And the stinkiest rear buttons for ages have been given to the Razer Wolverine Ultimate series for having an awkward cocked out angle that provides a lot of knuckle fatigue in long gaming sessions, slick plastics, not being able to remap on the fly directly from the controller, and most importantly, not being ergonomically comfortable, so you're going to end up using the face buttons or Dpad, which is the whole point of having these rear buttons, is to not have to take your fingers off thumbsticks, so you're constantly aiming and moving while you're still sliding and jumping and reloading and opening doors and touching yourself and whatever. I'm proud to polish off that trophy, dust it off, and proclaim that there's a new king of worst rear buttons, and it's this controller right in front of you.
I'd like to say that the cheaper version or variant of this controller has 2 rear buttons, and I'd like to get that controller in hand to test it, although from the pictures it looks pretty whack as well. First of all, if you don't want to use these rear buttons, just holding the controller naturally, your middle fingers are actually brushing up against them. That's uncomfortable. Then when you do want to use them, you might extend these middle fingers out and you're covering these 2 bottom buttons. Cool. You can hike up to the top buttons, but they're really high up and you only feel secure pressing them down where these lines are. I did say slick plastic. These aren't coated in rubber and don't have any good stippling or dots or anything. Just these lines that don't do anything. These are slick as snot. If you are someone that likes to cover all 4 buttons simultaneously, you can, but this feels pretty goddamned uncomfortable. The bottom 2 buttons also stick further from the rear shell than they should, which from a durability and reliability standpoint, not good because these could snap off. Although they do feel pretty secure. Somebody would have to do something pretty stupid to make that happen. But then we get down to brass tacks, the biggest problem here, and that is the fact that in order to rebind these, you cannot do it on the fly. You have to have the Armory Crate software, which Xbox consoles, the Xbox One and Series, don't have that third-party application available to you. So if you buy this Pro controller for Xbox, for one, you're going wired all the time, which sucks me, but you have 4 of the most uncomfortable rear buttons that I personally have tested that cannot be remapped on the fly.
But here's a $180 cheap feeling controller with the bare minimum warranty we can give you, but you can't use those rear buttons on Xbox. This is a pointless controller, but we have a screen, so that's, you can see how much battery life you have left.
Now in my controller reviews, anytime there's a software program or application, I do a full tour of the suite, and I'm using Armory Crate, which is actually a program I've already had installed because it controls my motherboard. Unfortunately, the controller isn't recognized just yet. Coming down here to this cog icon, then go to Update Center, you will see I have a, let's come over here for a second, there we go, a slew of updates available. Click on check for updates, and hopefully this gets the controller recognized, but I'm honestly not very hopeful because I feel like if it was going to be recognized, it would simply be plug and play, and it would pop up right here under devices. As you can see, I have my motherboard and then Fan Expert, which is the plugin to control my fans. Yeah, okay. but let's be hopeful and do the updates. As for modes or means of connectivity, you do have wired on the Xbox. That is going to be your only means. With that included 10-foot braided cable, you do have a wireless 2.4 gigahertz dongle for use on the PC. And there is also Bluetooth support, but you do need to download a separate driver. I couldn't find anywhere if this is Bluetooth 3.0, 5.0, 5.1. It's got Bluetooth though. The weight is 330 grams. That includes the cable. That is super funky that they include that. Your headset and headset mic will only work if you're going wired. As for battery life, you're going to get up to 48 hours, but that is with the lighting and vibration off. Over here, next input test, waiting to give the PC 1,000 samples of what this controller can do so we can get our stock input lag or delay, which is going to be 4 milliseconds
on a 250 hertz stock clock.
There we go, much better. The minimum and maximum closer to each other, a little bit more consistent. We do have 9 outliers, which if you scan through the numbers manually are going to be some very large or very small numbers that do not match up with the rest of its buddies. Probably going to be at the top. There's one. We got a 7.8 buried in there. I can say with a good degree of confidence that you're getting an average of 3.8 milliseconds of stock input lag or delay. That's wired. How about with that dongle? We are now connected to the PC wirelessly. Well, it's not turned on. You got to hold that home button for a few seconds. Don't just tap it. You got to lay on it for a minute. We're getting greedy by that aggressive welcome screen. Let's spin that left thumbstick in a circle, shall we? Ooh, that's not what I like to see. I would like to see the exact same numbers we were getting when we were wired, which you do see with some third-party dongles. You're not getting it here. We're actually getting double the speed at 8 milliseconds. Also a less consistent connection as well, as the minimum and maximum are further from each other and jitter is also higher. What we see here is that you're at 125 hertz clock when you're wireless and 250 hertz when you are wired. So you get to pick and choose. Do you want the comfort and convenience of going wireless and having 8 milliseconds of input lag or delay, or do you want 4, not having to worry about battery life but being tethered? That's up to you.
Can we overclock it?
Alrighty, my internet friends, we're in the Lord of Mice overclocking software. In this drop down, select all. You're going to see your Xbox gaming device not overclocked on the stock clock for an estimated 4 milliseconds of input lag or delay, which is true. That's a true fact. This is also an X input, not D input, which is not surprising because it's a modern controller. Can you force it into D input? No, not that I've discovered, which is weird because there are cheaper controllers where you can do that, which would give it additional support for older titles, maybe some emulation and stuff.
There is our candidate controller. Install service. Open. 1000. Install service. Open. Filter on device, please. Install service. Open. Unplug. Replug.
That controller's overclocked at 1000 hertz for an estimated 1 millisecond of input lag or delay. Let's test that friggin' theory. All right. Whipping and dipping in a circle, and we are still seeing 4 milliseconds while going wired. Let's try and overclock that dongle and see if that tautens anything up.
Back in the Lord of Mice overclocking software, going wireless this time, showing that it is not overclocked, but it is reflecting 1 millisecond of input lag or delay, which is interesting. Let's do our thing. Now you might be wondering, how are you going to unplug a wireless controller? Well, you can either turn it off by holding down the power button, or what I like to do is just disconnect the dongle and then plug that back in. As you will see, that controller did disappear on me.
And when we plug it back in, it shalt reappear, this time overclocked and ready for business. No speed boost overclocking the dongle. However, it is slightly more consistent, but that might just be a discrepancy. Let's run another one. Couple outliers. I can see some big numbers popping up in there. Yeah, straight up fluke. Still as inconsistent as the day it was born. Jitter's pretty gosh darn high as well. Still at the 125 hertz stock clock. This controller is not susceptible to being overclocked as it is pulling rate locked, both wireless and wired.
Show you some of the features or functions of that little OLED screen, which by the way, I'd have a whole hell of a lot more control of in the Armory Crate software, but I'm still unable to get it up and running. Despite doing all of these updates, also going to the software support page and downloading the optional Bluetooth driver, which does convert to X input. This is just Armory Crate, which I already have installed. I'm taking more steps than the average consumer would to get this up and working. I'm having more patience than most.
But you do still have some control of this OLED screen via two tiny buttons on the top of the controller. I believe it's supposed to be a select and a back button. However, the select button also works as a back button a lot of the time and just frustrates me.
Also, this controller powers itself off constantly, even when it's plugged in. So it's got to keep waking it up. Oh man, the screen won't even fucking turn on now. What's happening here? There it goes. So this is the default, super disorienting. Got yourself flashbanged and an epileptic seizure. Rad. Let's turn that right off. Holding down that left button will actually turn the screen on and off. Holding down the right button will pop you into an onboard option menu. Profile, wallpaper, status, system, screen, screen off time. It's flickering like a mamma jamma through the camera lens, but IRL, obviously it's not flickering. Screen brightness, profile. Wallpaper. Okay, it's looped back around. Sounds like a lot of stuff you can do. It's really not. You're really just going to be displaying your battery life and your profile. Also, little notation here, having to go into this screen and then scroll with those two tiny buttons to swap profiles as opposed to other controllers that just have a little profile swap button on the back. Not only is it gimmicky, it's inconvenient. Oh, the controller just powered itself off again. You saw it. Wake it back up.
Oh, there it goes. There we go. This is the menu that I like to have. Not that one. God damn it. And now it's like doing stuff on its own that I'm not asking it to do. So this is the status mode, which I think gives you the most information. This is where I'd like to leave it on. Shows you your profile, your battery life, as well as two icons. I'm assuming Bluetooth and dongle connection. OLED technology is freaking awesome when you're talking about TVs, monitors, maybe what the Switch 2 should have instead of that stupid LED screen they're going to give it. But 1.25-inch rectangle that's black and white and is just going to be flashing a ROG wallpaper at you. I just, you know, finish my sentence for me, please. Real quick, I need to give some praise to Asus, their gaming division ROG, for this level of transparency. They're showing real media reviews that are actually negative. This is from Tom's Hardware. So if you click on the article, it's going to be in Italian. However, there is a built-in translator into Google. So if you're using Chrome, you just tap over here, English. But this seems like an honest and unfortunately mostly negative review, but they decided to actually put it on their website to show that level of transparency that it's not reviewing too well. And I just noticed this at the very end of the review when I'm about to give my honest thoughts, which are indeed mostly negative, as this controller has a shitload of shortcomings. But it's cool that they put that on the website, and I also didn't want anyone watching this video to think that that negative review or anyone's out there swayed my opinion of this controller. So starting with the cons or shortcomings, first of all, the price tag is more than double what it should be for the feature set of this controller. Secondly, you can only use this controller wired on Xbox. Thirdly, there is no dedicated application, no Armory crate for the Xbox, so you have to have a PC in order to set up those profiles and rebind those rear buttons. But along those lines, you will have those profiles that you set up in Armory crate saved on board the controller, and those will take effect on the Xbox, in essence. But the next con is that the Armory crate application, even after updates and diddling with it, I wasn't able to get it up and running. I will post a follow-up video with a software tour if and when I actually get it up and running, but it was completely unusable, and you need it to bind the rear buttons. That's a huge deal. And the fact that I already had Armory Crate installed, I already know how to navigate it, and I still couldn't get the controller up and working with it is insane. Another little key point that the representative at Asus mentioned about the Raikiri Pro, and I think also the Raikiri Standard as well, is that you need to update the firmware at a separate website. There's a driver package that you don't get through the software application through Armory Crate. It actually pops up with the controller name in Armory Crate. That little software plugin that you add does nothing. The controller's still not usable in the Armory Crate. But supposedly, according to my mans over there, you can go to a separate support page at Asus and download it's a specific support page for the controller to push the day one patch to make it usable with the software program. I don't need to tell everyone watching this video you shouldn't need to do that with a Pro controller. It should launch in tip-top shape, ready to go with an application, which, by the way, should also be on the Xbox console, because not everyone owns a computer. Some people own multiple, but some people have zero because they don't like them in their houses, or they can't afford them, or whatever. Some people don't have a goddamn computer. And the people that do have a computer, the controller's not noticed in Armory Crate, and not everyone's going to have the information that I got from that big long email from the representative. So guess what? I'm going to do a follow-up video if I can actually get the software program working so I can give you a tour of Armory Crate, setting up your dead zones and stuff. Usually, controllers just plug and play support for the software program. I do a full tour in my reviews. Next up, the fact that you're getting half the speed with the wireless dongle as you do wired on the PC sucks. Cosmetically, I think this controller could have looked really cool, but it's a little bit too rambunctious. There's too much gamerificness going on, and the RGB is just, it's not implemented as slick as, say, for example, the Razer controllers. The build quality, all the plastics feel incredibly cheap. This OLED screen, as neato Toledo as it is, it's definitely a marketing gimmick and not an actual usable feature that you're going to ever actually glance down at and be like, oh, son of a gun, I'm low on battery, because you're going to get a low battery notification popping up on screen anyway. Actually, this controller doesn't give you pop-up notifications because it's communicating via like a third-party protocol. If you get one of those controllers that starts life as a stock Xbox controller and then it's disassembled and customized by a human being at one of these warehouses like HyperCinch, AIM, Battle Beaver, Evil, etc., they work as like a stock controller. You're able to wake the console from sleep, use it wirelessly, and you get low battery notifications and all that stuff because it starts as a stock controller. This not so much. It's along the lines of Razer and Thrustmaster, where it's its own thing, its own shell, its own printed circuit board. Not saying any of these companies make the parts in-house, because they probably don't. They source them from other vendors and stuff, but they assemble those bad boys in their own little warehouses, and it's very different from like a stock Xbox or PlayStation controller. And this money could have been reallocated towards better face buttons, maybe some mechanical joints, or having swappable thumbstick caps, or some higher quality triggers that are digital mechanical switches, or adding rubberized grips, or a multitude of other parts and components other than an OLED screen. Next up, there's no swappable thumbstick caps. That's a standard feature on a Pro controller. An oxymoron there. Standard on a Pro. It's an expected feature. nicer on a controller that's more expensive than a Stalker. But it's probably good there's no included swappable thumbstick caps because there's no carrying case with this $180 controller. The next con, you have to go to Best Buy or BestBuy.com to buy it, as opposed to other controllers where you can get them at Walmart, Amazon, like all over the place. Talking about the Elite, also PDP and Power A stock their controllers everywhere. The 3.5 millimeter headphone jack only works when you are wired. When you're playing wirelessly with the dongle, there's no support for it. It even mentions that in the instruction manual. That's dumb. Not a huge deal considering you probably have a separate set of wireless cans, a wireless headset. But if you're trying to use this 3.5 millimeter jack, you can jack yourself right off thinking about it. Also adding to the cosmetics, that huge label with that serial number is an eyesore on the back of the controller. Speaking of the back of the controller, one of the biggest cons, in my opinion, is going to be the rear button design. For God's sake, I gave it an award, a golden medallion, a trophy, an accolade, a prestige point, if you will, for having the worst rear buttons that I have reviewed currently up to this date that we're all sitting on here today. Prior to this, the worst rear button design, in my opinion, was the Razer Ultimate series, but this is very similar to those, but even worse because they're harder to hit. The plastics feel even cheaper, slicker. You can't rebind these bad boys, but on the PC, and that's if you can get the application running. They're not in a good ergonomic position. These top ones are high as hell. You thought I was high? No, these top rear buttons are high as fuck. Cheech and Chong, this is just a... I'm gonna set it down.
I'll just bury it down inside.
Bury it deep down in there and never bring it up again.
It's painful. And I love you.
I also didn't like the way that they worded their warranty and that they would do the bare minimum required by law, depending on your region. It's literally the minimum wage equivalent of warranties. And the thing is, there are companies that do less than 1 year, which is the standard legal North American standard. For example, Scuff and Hex, that's a 6-month warranty for you. That is a set in stone warranty for you. And has anybody actually tried to take them to court and be like, well, there's a consumer law in North America that you have to have 365 days of coverage? Has that actually gotten honored ever? I don't know. As for the pros, is there even a pro section of this video? Yes, I will say that the thumbsticks performed very good in Gamepad Tester, not only with the circularity test, good resting value, also in gameplay they felt normal, we'll say that. They felt like normal thumbsticks. Trying to give it some praise. Another pro would be the quoted battery life at 48 hours. That is pretty gosh darn long. Granted, that is quoted as having the RGB and vibration turned off. OLED screen, not the vibration, although that would probably help as well. As for the Elite Series 2 has 40 hours of quoted battery life and you don't have to turn off the vibration. It doesn't have lights or anything like that. But I have said multiple times in the past, that is a very, very conservative quote from Microsoft. Generally, companies over promise and under deliver. That's actually the opposite when it comes to the case of the battery with the Series 2, because standby time is unbelievable and consistent use, you're probably going to get more than 40 hours out of it. The battery on board that beast is beastly. But on paper, if you turn off the RGB, which I certainly did with this controller, because like I said, I didn't think it was implemented in a very sexy way compared to like the Razer controllers, where you barely see the RGB because it's where your hands are holding it, and it just looks a little sleeker. Probably not disabling vibration, unless I'm playing some competitive shooter on the PC where I don't care about vibration. Quoted battery life that I have not tested yet as a pro. Also, that 3.5 millimeter headphone jack, which I said looked cheap and a little bit silly being off to the left instead of centered, is actually ESS Saber DAC and amp. I'm assuming that means it has a built-in amplifier. That was some of the information directly from the representative in the email. I didn't notice any difference in quality, better or worse, through that 3.5 millimeter jack. But because they used a high quality component there, I'm gonna list it as a pro. And one last note, I'm gonna wrap this sucker up because this video is running long and running strong. As soon as I get the go-ahead from that representative that it's okay to share all the testing statistics, such as their drop test and their lifespan testing and all that, that that's not cloaked under some black magic voodoo and that that's open to the public, then I will make a pinned comment with all of the information that I got from the representative that is okay to share with y'all. So we can get that last piece of the puzzle, a new view, a new angle on this controller, what the company says, and then my 38 minutes of ranting about how I'm not super moist about this controller. What the hell do I know, though? It's not like I'm the gamepad guru of YouTube, the go-to controller channel or anything like that. Coming from a fan of other ROG devices, do not buy this controller. Quick, just to close everything out, because I hate to provide problems and not give solutions, so since I didn't really recommend this controller and I do blatantly think there's better places that you can spend $180, instead of me just saying that and then not giving you alternatives or options, for example, the Elite Series 2 has been out since 2019. It's on sale constantly, especially near Black Friday and holidays. And despite quality quality control issues, which it does seem have been getting better as new batches have been coming out from Microsoft. And they've also made official statements about the quality improving over time with their Elite controllers. You can pick those up for $160 all day. Also, a lot of these custom controller companies do have entry-level models that will have four remappable rear buttons and those three performance staples that I brag about for under $200 if you want to skip over all the cosmetic tweaks and goodies. If you are going to spec out one of those super expensive controllers, make sure you check the description of the video first, because there are some exclusive discounts down there that'll shave off a good portion of your purchase. And furthermore, the best resource that I can give you is just last month I made the best Xbox controller video, which is 31 controllers compared in three different price points, $60 and under, $60 to $180, and then $180 and up. So this controller, after tax and shipping, would fall in that $180 and up flagship category, where I think your money could better be reallocated. However, if you've already purchased this controller, you're out of the spec of refund, don't beat yourself up about it. If you're enjoying it, that's really all that counts. I'm sorry I couldn't solidify your purchase. Also, I would like to say the cosmetics have grown on me a little bit. I said it was too gamerific and flashy, but actually from a distance, it kind of just looks like a gray black controller. And then you get up close on it and you're like, oh, little ROG logos. And this part's clear on the right. It actually looks kind of cool, but that white Xbox home button jewel does kill the cosmetics, and it still doesn't feel good.